Coming up on Locked On Dodgers, we take a couple questions from listeners, talking about Max Muncy, talking about Carlos Correa, and then we take a look at the remaining free agent starting pitchers to see if there's anybody the Dodgers would be interested in. That's what's on tap, so make sure to keep it Locked On Dodgers.
You are Locked On Dodgers, your daily Los Angeles Dodgers podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Yo, 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 Dodger fans, welcome to Locked On Dodgers. We are part of the Locked On Podcast Network, the number one local sports daily podcast network. Locked On, your team every day. Today's episode is brought to you by BetOnline. BetOnline has you covered this season with more props, odds, and lines than ever before. BetOnline, where the game starts. This is the daily Los Angeles Dodgers podcast, bringing you the smart fans' perspective on our boys in blue every Monday through Friday. We are found wherever you find podcasts and on YouTube simply by searching for Locked On Dodgers. And if this is your first time listening or watching, I'm Vince Samperio, usually joined by co-host Jeff Snider, although I'll be going solo dolo today, as I have been known to say. Jeff had some family stuff that he needed to get to bed early on, and as we record late sometimes, I took over for him and we got it covered. We're both lifelong Dodger fans that have spent time covering the Dodgers and currently cover the Dodgers. And we bring the smart fans perspective on our boys in blue every weekday morning, Monday through Friday, for about 30 minutes, which is what we're going to do today. Monday, New Year. Happy New Year, everybody. 2023 is here. Hopefully the year the Dodgers win the World Series. No news really over the weekend, not just in the Dodger world, but really in the baseball world. Nothing, you know, really happened. And now we're here and we're in 2023. We're about 6 weeks away from pitchers and catchers reporting. So we're starting to look ahead toward the new season. And we continue to wait to see if the Dodgers do anything else. But until that happens, we're going to operate as if the current roster is the roster we're going to see come spring training, come opening day. And that's how we're going to operate, and that's how we're going to talk, and that's how we're going to look at it. And it's going to start a little bit today. Jeff asked me a little bit later if I could go solo, so I put out a call for questions, but it was a little bit late on a Sunday night, so didn't get too many. But we got a couple, and those can be turned into a question as a whole, a greater question as a whole. So let's hop right into it. We got one from our buddy Pat Dwyer at The Real PJ Dwyer. He says, any news on Max Muncy and his health? I've not seen anything reported, so I assume no, but I'm curious how he's feeling going into 2023. Yeah, unfortunately, I didn't have the direct line to Max Muncy, but as Pat said, we haven't heard anything, so you would imagine that everything is all good with Max Muncy. You would imagine that he's coming in 100% healthy into the season. And knowing that and kind of knowing what this roster is, I kind of wanted to take a look at third base and see, you know, what the plan is at third base, what the Dodgers are going to do, how are they going to handle it. And essentially, at this point, it comes down to Max Muncy and Miguel Vargas. Not necessarily meaning that it's going to be Max, like, you know, the other one goes to the bench. They're both going to be getting significant playing time for the Dodgers, if not every day. You know, Max Muncy for sure, everyday player. Miguel Vargas, it appears that they're going to give him the runway as potentially an everyday player. But it's a matter of, you know, who plays third base. Max Muncy handled third base more so than he has in the past last year, with Justin Turner handling DH a lot of the time and you know, the way that went. But you know, you look at it, and we've been quick to dismiss Miguel Vargas at third base. You know, we've said that he probably going to play left, maybe a little bit of second. We haven't really fully given him, you know, a look at third base. And it would help if Miguel Vargas could handle third base full time, because then you got Max Muncy at second base. And then, you know, you open up Chris Taylor to be an outfielder. You keep other guys out there, you know, other people that can play multiple positions, you can, you know, have them focus on the outfield, left field, center field, where the Dodgers need people. But, you know, you take a look at it and you see why Miguel Vargas has maybe been a little bit, I don't know, not a lot of confidence in him being a third baseman. And it's hard with the minor leagues because there's not too much defensive data out there. At least that's not easily readily available to find. But you look at Miguel Vargas, just, you know, some raw numbers, and you look at his time in the minors at third base, and he's made 58 errors in 296 games at third base. Fielding percentage of .922. Now, fielding percentage is something, you know, Jeff and I have talked about that doesn't really indicate too much on the defensive value, because, you know, if you have limited range, you might not make as many errors because you don't get it to as many baseballs. But when we talk about fielding percentage not being, you know, a great indicator, that's usually when guys are in the fielding percentages, you know, 980, 990, 995, which is a lot of Major League Baseball players who, you know, for the most part, Major League Baseball players on good baseball teams have fielding percentages above 980. So when you're talking about the difference between 980 and 995, it's not necessarily a big deal. And you do have to get into some defensive metrics to kind of see, you know, range and everything else. But with Miguel Vargas, I mean, a 922 fielding percentage, now that's notable because that's lower than, you know, you would expect. You know, 58 errors, 296 games, that's not, you know, the greatest ratio. So you look at it and you're like, okay, well, maybe, you know, he struggled at first, but he kind of came on after that, and not so much. He had 10 errors in 36 games in 2018 across a couple leagues, and then, you know, only a couple errors in the Arizona Fall League. You look into 2019, he had 16 errors in 101 games, or 20 errors in 101 games. Okay, yeah, that's not great, but maybe he's getting better. And then you look at 2022, and he had 15 errors in 74 games. So, yeah, the ratio didn't get much better. He continued to struggle defensively. Now, what this doesn't tell us is, are they fielding errors? Are they throwing errors? Not that it matters. An error is an error, but, you know, if it's a fielding error, I feel like that's a little bit more difficult to deal with than throwing error, because throwing errors can come from a variety of things. You know, we talked about Gavin Lux and his New Year's resolution to relax, and, you know, some of his throwing errors seem to come from him getting in his own head. And if Miguel Vargas, you know, we haven't heard anything about him having yips or anything, so I would imagine it's just a mix of, you know, defensive errors and throwing errors. But it raises some flags in that end of, can this guy play third base every time? And, you know, what we've seen a lot this offseason from reporters and from Dave Roberts and everyone else is that Miguel Vargas has been working out. He's been working on his defense. You know, he's been working third, been working at second base. So, but how much better can he get from all that? And that's what we don't know. And that's where it's hard to say, okay, Miguel Vargas, you can be our third baseman, because, you know, while he can offset a lot of what he does defensively, offensively, that much I don't think he can offset, you know, making a fielding percentage under 950, you know, errors, you know, averaging kind of pretty much an error every five or six games, not necessarily the hardest thing to, or not necessarily the most easiest thing to overcome with the offense, especially as a rookie and a guy who, you know, you don't know what you're going to get from him offensively. So, can he play third base? If not, you know, is Max Muncy the full-time third baseman? There's still some questions for us to get into. But first, we need to talk about BetOnline, because today's episode is brought to you by BetOnline. BetOnline.net is your number one source for sports betting info, stats, news, and analysis. Get the latest odds and trends for every professional and amateur league out there, from pro football to bowl season to basketball. We've got it all at BetOnline.net. And if you love sports podcasts, they got it there as well. Head to BetOnline for the fastest and easiest way to get your betting info. Check it out on your laptop or your mobile device to learn more. BetOnline, where the game starts. All right, let's get back into it. And, okay, so, you know, assuming Miguel Vargas can improve marginally at third base, he may get some time there at third base. I don't know if he'll improve enough to, you know, be the everyday guy. And I don't know, you know, this is hard to speculate on what the Dodgers are thinking. You know, are the Dodgers going to give him some leash at third base, you know, throw him out there to start the season with the hopes that, you know, they can get Max Muncy at second base and solidify the entire infield, leaving room for the outfield. Because if you can get Miguel Vargas and Max Muncy to be your combination second, third base, however it works out, and Chris Taylor can be more of a full-time outfielder type, then you're in a pretty decent shape because, you know, you have that versatility. Whereas if Miguel Vargas is in the outfield, now you're a little bit struggling in the outfield and left field because, you know, he's still learning that position. You got Max Muncy at third base who can play a pretty decent third base. And then at second base, you kind of need, you know, Chris Taylor to work out. But if Chris Taylor is more of an everyday second baseman, he loses a little bit of value in terms of versatility. So, you know, everything that goes on with it. But back to Miguel Vargas, I think this is what I would think. If he's shown enough in this offseason, if he's worked enough that you believe he can play a capable third base and maybe grow into the position, I'd love to see Miguel Vargas at third base and leaving Max Muncy for second base, just because that, like I said, it solidifies your infield. You have a set infield of sorts, and then you can move Chris Taylor around to wherever you need him. You know, you can maybe have Michael Bush play second and Muncy move over to third if you know you are facing a tough right-hander, or you need Vargas and left, you know, whatever the case is, you have more versatility if Vargas can be a guy that can play third base. If not, you know, he's limited to left field and maybe second base. And he has fared better at second base, but in very limited sample size at second base. He's only played 28 career games in the minors at second base. He made 3 errors. So a lot better defensively there. But still, you know, that was second base is going to be a little bit different this year, especially in the majors without the shift. You know, it relies a little bit more on range, and range is harder to tell with errors, like I said, because you might not make that many errors if you don't get to as many balls as other players possibly would. So a little bit tough there. But I would like to see the Dodgers give Miguel Vargas some reign there at third base. You know, give him a month, see what happens, and go from there. Because if he can lock down third base and get comfortable and get confident at it, then it opens up everything else for the Dodgers. And yeah, that's what I'm hoping happens at third base. But obviously, that remains to be seen. The next question we have is just going to lend itself to second base, even though it's not asking about a second baseman directly. It's from Brandon at B_Kahaley. I don't know. You tell me how it's spelled, Brandon. But or not how it's spelled. You tell me how it's said. But he says, are we in on Carlos Correa? And this one's interesting because the Carlos Correa front has been very quiet the last few days. We haven't heard anything. But, you know, the reports were that him and the Mets were still working it out, and they were hoping to work it out. And it seemed like even if it doesn't end up being the 12-year deal that was initially agreed upon, that he would still work it out with the Mets, or maybe they put in some language in regards to, you know, injuries and everything else. So that remains to be seen. I would imagine the Dodgers have had some contact with Scott Boras, potentially, of even if it's just a checking in of, hey, you know, what's the word on Carlos Correa? Is it, you know, opening back up? Is there a chance for us to get him at maybe a low, you know, the deal that they want? I wouldn't say the Dodgers are in on Carlos Correa. I would imagine they've kicked the tires, they've asked the questions, and since we haven't seen much, I don't know if, you know, Boras and them are, I don't know if that's a product of Boras and the Mets are working diligently to make this deal happen. It's a matter of, hey, maybe they took a little bit of a break around the holidays and the new year, and, you know, they'll pick it back up now, or if, you know, it's an indicator of anything else. But yeah, I would imagine the Dodgers have asked at least about Carlos Correa, and that would still remain, I guess it still remains a possibility up until he officially signs, though I don't really see it happening. I don't, you know, can't see that being the case, but you never know. But this kind of keeps it in the infield and moving over to second base, and that's kind of where it's the same guys. It's Miguel Vargas and Max Muncy, although at second base you can get you can throw a couple more names into that mix. But, you know, going off, if it's as simple as Miguel Vargas is playing third base, then Max Muncy is playing second base, and your infield set. You know, you got Freddie, you got Muncy, you got Lux, you got Vargas, you know, and then you got Will Smith, JD Martinez at DH. And we'll get maybe into the outfield a little bit tomorrow based on that. So, you know, that's the easiest way to go. Now, if Miguel Vargas isn't playing third base, realistically, that probably means Max Muncy is playing third base, and that opens up second base. Now, like I said, Miguel Vargas has played some second base. The reports are that he has been working at second base this offseason. And, you know, second base is not easier than third base, but it's a little bit easier than third base. But also that was with the shift where you can play guys back more. You can give them more, you know, more opportunity for range playing in the grass. Whereas this season, you won't be able to do that. You'll have to have 1 foot on the dirt, you know, basically until the pitch is released. And you don't, you know, you limit your range if you don't already have range at second base. Now, you know, can the Dodgers get away with that? They can still get away with it because they can still position guys in different spots. Now, you know, they won't be able to position them in the grass, but they'll still be able to position them, you know, left, right, however they need to, and they'll still be able to use that to their advantage. So, you know, it's interesting because, you know, we don't know how teams are going to play this. Are they going to play it basically the same way where other than the guys not playing in the grass? I don't know. You know, are they going to play a little bit more straight up than in years past? Are they going to, you know, move guys over towards first a little bit more and leave the middle of the field a little bit more open? There's a lot of questions there as to how teams and how the Dodgers are going to handle that. But all in all, I would imagine that Miguel Vargas could handle second base and not – it's easier to hide him at second base than at third base is what basically what it comes down to. And, you know, can he do it? Yeah, probably. Will he be able to? I don't know. But that would open up, you know, if Max Muncy's at third, Miguel Vargas can't play second. The other, you know, people that can play second base, Chris Taylor obviously can play second base. He can also play third. He can also play short. It's, you know, we've talked about this before. If you have Chris Taylor locked in on one position, can he still be good if he recovers offensively? Yes, it would, you know, still be worth whatever they're paying him and still be, you know, fill a hole in their lineup. But again, his value comes from being able to play multiple positions and still be basically be an everyday player, but just moving around. If you lock in Chris Taylor at second base, I do think he loses some of his value, although he could, you know, be one of the best second basemen in baseball technically, and his value would still be there. But I think his value to the Dodgers is moving around and playing every day almost, but not at one position. The other name at second base is Michael Busch. And Michael Busch as a prospect is interesting just in the fact that I feel like I don't know how the Dodgers feel about him. Or maybe we do know how the Dodgers feel about him, because you keep seeing that, oh, he can hit in the majors now. He can hit in the majors now. We've seen that, you know, being said at least a couple times in the last couple years. And the Dodgers haven't been lacking for guys. Now, they haven't necessarily been lacking for a second baseman because they've had Gavin Lux for the most part the last couple years. But I feel like Michael Busch, if he could swing it in the way the Dodgers have needed guys that could hit the ball the last couple years, I feel like there would have been room for him to be added to the roster, and they haven't done so. And I don't know if, you know, if that's a matter of just based on versatility and the positional flexibility. You know, they haven't necessarily needed an infielder per se the last couple of years. They've needed more outfielders, but, you know, still, I feel like if they needed guys that could hit, he could have provided better at bats than some of the guys they've given at bats to in recent years. Now, obviously it's a roster thing and everything else, and, you know, 40 man and all that kind of stuff. But I feel like they're maybe not as high as him as it seems to be, and maybe that's why we haven't seen him yet. And, you know, now he was a first baseman. They taught him second base. You know, he's played a pretty strong second base, but again, not being able to play in the dirt might change things. We don't know. But, you know, ideal world, or not, maybe not ideal, or potentially ideal, he plays second, Muncy plays third, Vargas plays left, and there's no questions and qualms at all, and they all hit, and it's, you know, happy times for the Dodgers. But realistically, you know, the best way to go about it right now without knowing what Michael Busch can do is Muncy at third, or Vargas at third, Muncy at second, and then Busch maybe off the bench. So, that's the infield right now, and there's still a ways to go. And potentially, you know, all this could be moot if the Dodgers made a move in the next month or whatever it is. But that's how I kind of see it right now, that I'd like to see it Vargas at third, Muncy at second, and that opens up a lot of doors for everybody else. But I would love if Michael Busch just came in and was a hitter and they made adjustments, and then you got, you know, Miguel Vargas in left field, Muncy at third, and you got above average hitters at three different spots. So ideally that's what happens, but that's where I'm at on the infield right now. We'll transition this into some outfield talk and, you know, bring in some of the same names and elements that we had right now, probably on tomorrow's episode, unless some breaking news happens. So we're going to finish this episode looking at free agent starting pitchers, anyone the Dodgers can go after. Do the Dodgers still need starting pitching? We'll take a look. But first, let's talk about Built Bar, because Built Bar is the best tasting protein bar out there. And today's episode is brought to you by Built Bar. So if you're looking for a delicious treat but don't want all the fat and calories, you got to try Built Bar. Just got through the holidays, and, you know, a lot of us probably have goals of 2023 of being a little healthier. You know, maybe not necessarily any crazy goals, but you just want to be healthy overall. And Built Bar can help with that. And Built Bar makes healthy tasty. So that's what's good for there. Perfect for any New Year's resolutions. They're covered in 100% real chocolate, but they're still good for you. They got crazy flavors like churro, peanut butter brownie, coconut almond. Tastes like a candy bar, but it's a great protein bar with low calories, low sugar, high protein, high fiber, everything you could want in the good stuff, not all the bad stuff. And they're right there for you. So right now you can find them at your local Walmart or Sam's Club, and you can check them out. Walk to the pharmacy section, grab yourself a box of Built Bars. They got 4-bar boxes. They got the 13-bar box, anything you can think of, not anything, but they got a lot of Built Bars there. So head over to your local Walmart, pick up some Built Bars, and you can thank us later. Thank you for making Locked On Dodgers your first listen of the day every day. Check out Locked On MLB Prospects. Host Lindsey Crosby is a prospect encyclopedia, and he's going deep on the MLB stars of tomorrow. It's free and available wherever you get podcasts. All right, let's finish out the episode talking some free agency and starting pitchers. Do the Dodgers need a starting pitcher? Every baseball team could use more starting pitchers, definitely. I do think the Dodgers could benefit from having one more veteran starter on the roster. But it's tricky because, you know, technically you do have a 5-man rotation right now with Julio and Kershaw and Syndergaard and Gonsolin and Dustin May. Sitting behind them are the young guys, the prospects, Pepio, Andre Jackson, Michael Grove. And then sitting behind them in the next tier, Bobby Miller and Gavin Stone. So, you know, by that count, there's 10 guys that could be starting pitchers for the Dodgers. But again, it's a matter of innings and how you handle these guys and everything else. You know, Kershaw probably not going to make 32 starts, probably makes in the 20 to 25 range. You know, Tony Gonsolin had some issues last year once the numbers ran up in terms of his, you know, in terms of usage. Will that happen again? We can't be sure. So, you know, can you count on Gonsolin for 30 starts? We don't know. Dustin May, can you count on him for 30 starts? Probably not. Even though he is over a year removed from Tommy John, it's still, you know, we saw Noah Syndergaard was over a year removed from Tommy John, and last year he pitched, you know, he was able to give innings and make those starts. It wasn't as effective. You know, Dustin May did come out still throwing BBs, but still needed to figure some things out. And it's not a guarantee that he will figure those things out. Unfortunately, it's not a guarantee. Noah Syndergaard, can you count on him for 30 starts? At this point, maybe. You know, there's nothing to say no based on what he did last year and based on the fact that you don't expect him to get hurt. So there's potential there. You know, Pepio, Grove, Andre Jackson, at this point, those guys are a little bit, you know, you don't know exactly that, but at the Pepio has the highest ceiling, maybe. The other guys might have higher floors in terms of being productive major league players. None of them really sit anything above, you know, third starter in terms of projected ability. But you don't necessarily need that right now, but like I said. And then Miller and Stone, it's going to be a matter of you don't want them in your rotation the whole year. They'll maybe come up at some point throughout the year, make some spot starts. I doubt any of them get fully thrown into a starting rotation role just based on the fact that the Dodgers probably want to protect their arms. But, yeah, hey. So with all that being said, you know, the Dodgers could use one more veteran arm that could be a guy similar to like the Tyler Anderson deal last year, you know, 1 year deal, not a lot of money. You know, Tyler Anderson didn't start the season in the starting rotation. He was piggybacked with Tony Gonsolin and then worked his way into the rotation after injuries and everything else. Who's available now? Free agents. There's not a lot available. I'm just going to go through based on 2020 or based on combined WAR from the last 2 years. These are the five best starters still available right now. You got Wade Miley, Zach Greinke, Michael Wacha, Mike Minor, Eric Fetty. Not a lot of names that inspire a lot. Other intriguing names that you might have heard of before that are available still on the open market: Michael Pineda, Dylan Bundy, Chris Archer, Carlos Martinez, Zach Davies, Dallas Keuchel. That's pretty much it in terms of names. Now, of all those names, do you really want any of those names? Not necessarily. Chris Archer is always going to be an intriguing name just because he was good at one point before, and the Dodgers, you know, have had success with some reclamation projects in the past. But realistically, if you're going to go after Chris Archer, I believe Pepio Jackson and Grove can give you similar production, and you already have them on the roster. So, you know, the one name that we've talked about before is, or at least mentioned on this podcast, is Wade Miley. He would be that guy. You know, he's reliable. He, you know, probably wouldn't cost much. He probably wouldn't have expectations of being, you know, a for sure starting pitcher. But if he's not a starting pitcher that's, you know, consistently giving you 5-6 innings every time out, I don't know if he brings much value as a reliever. He doesn't have, you know, crazy stuff. He doesn't throw hard. He doesn't, you know, do anything. He's a guy that needs to be able to pitch. And if it comes down to reliever role, guys that need to be able to pitch, maybe not necessarily the guy that works out as much. That's similar to Zach Greinke. If Zach Greinke is not a starting pitcher, he doesn't bring much value as a reliever. And not saying that they can't. You know, Wade Miley and Zach Greinke could bring value at reliever, but I do think the best bet for them is to be a guy that pitches every fifth day, gives you 5 or 6 innings a couple times through a lineup. And, you know, more so, you know, they're guys that, hey, you know what, you need to wear this one today. We need you to throw, you know, 105 pitches and get as deep into the game as you can. Those are guys that you can focus on that with more so than some of these others. Michael Wacha is intriguing. He's still young, 30 years old. He had a pretty decent season with the Red Sox. Again, not a lot of would be cheap. A decent season for him is, you know, number 4 or 5 starter quality. And it's a matter of, you know, do you want to bring in someone else number four, number five starter quality when you have 3 guys that could be number 4 or 5 starter quality and Pepio Jackson and Grove already on the roster? I don't think so. And then you got Mike Minor, Eric Fetty. Both guys that, you know, don't inspire much, don't excite much. So when you look at all that, unless you sign Wade Miley and you're giving him a full-time role in the rotation, I don't think there's anything out there for the Dodgers in the free agent market. I think if you're already in on trusting young guys, then stay in on trusting young guys and trust Pepio and Jackson and Grove. And honestly, I think as long as none of them are, you know, Pepio, if he can figure out how to throw strikes, maybe. But as long as none of those guys are higher than your number 4 starter, then I think the Dodgers are fine. Right now, none of those guys are projected to be in the starting rotation unless the Dodgers do go to a six-man rotation. So I think the Dodgers find a starting pitcher. Now, if there's availability to get somebody that slots into the number one or two spot in your rotation, that would come via trade. That is, I still welcome, and I still think the Dodgers could benefit from that. But when it comes down to somebody to fill in the back end of the rotation, I think they have guys that can fill in admirably at those roles and maybe even thrive in those roles. So I don't think there's any free agents starting pitching that really moves the needle for the Dodgers. It makes sense. So thank you all for listening. That's going to do it for today's episode. We will be here all week as we usually are. Thank you for making us your first listen. For your next listen, check out Locked On MLB Prospects with Lindsey Crosby. It's free and available wherever you get podcasts. We'll be back. I'll be back solo, I believe, tomorrow, talking about anything that happens, maybe getting into some outfield talk, taking a look at some free agent relievers, and we'll go from there. We thank you for listening to Locked On Dodgers. We thank you for following us wherever you follow us, subscribing wherever you subscribe. We'd appreciate it if you could tell your friends and family about us. Word of mouth is still one of the strongest ways for us to grow and continue to grow. And, you know, it's been a weird offseason for the Dodgers, but you guys have still been here all offseason, so we appreciate that. You can find us on social media, Twitter and Instagram at Locked On Dodgers. Jeff is on Twitter at Snider. I'm at Vince Samperio. DMs are open on all those accounts if you need to get a hold of us. Any questions, you can send to any of those accounts. If you have any questions, comments, you can also send those via email, lockedondodgers@gmail.com, or via voicemail text at 323-863-5625. We're here every weekday morning, and we hope you'll be with us. When you get in your car, or if you're at home, tell your smart device, play a podcast, Locked On Dodgers. And remember, you don't have to agree. You just have to listen. Have a good one.